Welcome to the Zandbergen Report, where wealth strategies and investment wisdom collide, featuring your distinguished host and certified financial planner, Bart Zandbergen.
Welcome to the Zandbergen Report, a showcase for wealth strategies and investment wisdom for our evolving world. I'm your host, Bart Zandbergen. In studio is my trusted partner, Letitia Birbaum.
Hello, hello.
And of course, how can we do the show without Paul?
The old guy in the room.
Well, we have got, I think, a really interesting show today. And the topic is something that we've been carrying on for the last few months.
Before you do that, aren't you going to announce the big news? It's flashing around Hollywood. I think it's the front page of Variety right now.
No.
No? Okay, all right. We're going to save it till later.
It'll be a surprise.
That's
all right.
Later.
Okay.
Are you, okay.
Does this one work?
Yeah, you're on.
Okay.
All right, here we go. Technical difficulties and everything.
So we've teased it. There's a big announcement coming. Just keep tuning in.
It's coming. But the topic is what keeps you up at night. And we've taken a little bit of a different approach. Letitia and I have actually contacted some of our top clients and contacts. And these are all very, very affluent and or wealthy people. And we've asked them that direct question. What keeps you up at night? So, Paul, I'm going to start with what keeps you up at night.
Me? Oh, yeah. I got to do this. You know, to get serious for a moment, I'm in my mid-60s. I look ahead and I say, my generation is going to be the longest lived generation in history. Doesn't mean I'm going to join them, but as a group, we're going to regularly get into the 90s, maybe the hundreds and beyond. How the hell are we going to pay? Lucky me, I'm going to live to be 95. Bad news, how am I going to pay for it? Mm-hmm. I mean, what, you know, do I set enough money to live for 30 years? No, I don't think anybody in my generation did. We're not prepared for this newfound bonus round.
Young wife.
That just caused even more. No, seriously, though, I think, you know, I hear a lot of people saying, there used to be a number. You know, if my dad retired, he thought he'd live for 5 years or so after he retired. Now it could be 30 years after you retire. So what are you going to do to make it last that long? And what's the number? What's it going to look like 30 years from now?
It's interesting that you say that. And the part that I wanted just to clarify, I was literally working on a plan today about the same thing. So the big question is, as we factor in when we do planning with clients, when you know, we always say projection, what's your family history? How long do you plan on living? Or what's their projection, how long they've lived? And then we always set at least a minimum at 90. And then we go from there if their family has a longer history of mortality. And so what we're trying to determine is, at the end of the day, how they can handle their cash flow over a period of time and be able to have their money last until their age.
Or am I going to be asking, you know, would you like fries with that order at 90?
And we do that. So that's a really interesting conversation, because it can get really intense in a room.
Yeah.
And you can have clients that you're like, okay, I've accumulated a nice sum of a pot of gold or a wealth of money,
right,
that they've accumulated over years. And then now we have to determine how that's going to last over a period of time.
Yeah.
So we look at their expenses, we look at their cash flow, we look at their required money that goes in and out, and then we stress test that. We say, okay, what's your portfolio doing? What's your expenses and what's your cash and savings? And sometimes people want to be super frugal and say, okay, I'm going to put all my money under the mattress or checking or savings, but that might not be enough money to have enough money to earn past inflation.
And how do you two project what everything's going to cost? It's one thing to say, I know what inflation's going to be over the next few years.
Yeah.
I know what housing's going to be, et cetera, et cetera. 30 years could be a game changer.
Well, anything can change, but we have to start somewhere with a plan in mind, and we stress test it, and we run Monte Carlo simulations, which is just...
Monte Carlo? What's that?
So it's... Go ahead. It's a formula that...
It's actually a formula and a system that uses the name Monte Carlo, but it runs it through every conceivable scenario.
It's like 1,000 different tests it runs.
And it gives you the percentage chance that you're going to meet whatever your goal is.
Probability.
I like that. I've never heard of that before.
Yeah.
You should talk about that. Well, the one thing, and then I'll shut up, the one thing that I took away from one of your shows earlier, you had a guy come on, and I asked him after the show, what's the number? What do you need to retire? He says, not a number anymore. It's a formula. And three his times. Formula was three times whatever you got to have a house paid off, and then take whatever that house is and three times that. So if you only have $1 million, then you better go buy a $200,000 house. If you got $5 million, you can have a $1 million house or whatever. Figure out, get a house paid, and then have three times that value of that house saved, and you should be okay. I thought that
And that's a really simple, like, nuts and bolts, but what I was describing is we go into depth do planning to actually understand what the probability is for you in your own unique situation, how you are going to meet your specific goals and
But
needs.
Isn't it true that most baby boomers like me have less than $50,000 saved, and we're not going to, 1 in 10 of us get a pension, and yet we're going to live for 30 more years?
There's a lot of statistics. There's a lot of statistics out there. So we handle every client differently, and everyone has their own goals and needs, and sometimes they have to scale back and live within their means, and everyone defines that slightly different.
Okay. Look forward to hearing more.
All right. So the first answer was probably the most out of the box that I expected to hear.
Mm-hmm.
And this was a question I asked of a gentleman who is successful beyond probably any imagination. And so when asked, he paused not for very long, and he says he worries about the next deal.
Ooh, describe. What's the next deal?
Yeah. So the next deal, what's the next business am I going to get into? What's the next thing that I'm going to do? And he described it as...
How about the next investment?
The kill of the deal. So, and for him...
So this is an old CEO, I'm sure.
Surprisingly not.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, yeah. If I told you what he did, it's so
unique. Don't.
I can't because it'll give away who he is. I wish I could, but I can't do that.
Confidentiality.
But with that...
What age range is he in? I mean,
he's 55.
So he's still thinking, I got time to do more deals. Because at some point, that's my fear, is your deal-making days done? Or will this go right up till 90?
Yeah.
I think you have time to always reinvent yourself. And we talk about that all the time as we have company owners that are getting ready to retire or sell their business or have an invention or their stock options mature and they're ready to go to the next company, or they're an athlete and they are retiring at a young age. People reinvent themselves all the time, so this is a very common conversation.
But there's a takeaway from this too, and I'm going to get to it in just a second. But just to kind of finish, I'm putting a wrapper on this. This is a gentleman that runs a successful business currently. It doesn't require a lot of effort from him, but it's a successful business that generates more money than you can imagine. But he's also diversified, not only in stuff that you know, Letitia and I would do, but he has other businesses and he has real estate. He has some passive investments.
His cash flow is diversified.
He's done some car washes.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a business that he's had for many, many years.
We had somebody else in here a while ago talking about diversification, and not so much, we think of that in terms of stocks and bonds or investments, but they said multiple businesses creating multiple cash flows.
Yeah.
And people don't think of that. If you're wealthy, I'm going to own a car wash. That doesn't sound too sexy, but that's... comes in nice when you're 80 and it's providing some residual income.
Yeah, exactly.
Absolutely. And we believe that as a firm as well.
But I think one of the takeaways of that is, and Letitia and I have seen this numerous, numerous times, once a lot of people become wealthy, some people become wealthy because they've done a great job of saving over time. But for those who have had a liquidation event, they've sold a business, and or, I mean, there's the lottery winners, there's the inheritances. And the statistics on that are overwhelming, that within 3 years, they're now broke.
Yeah.
And partial because they just go out and blow money. But the other
money management.
But the other part is, and this is my takeaway from him as well, is, and we've seen it with our top clients, they are on a daily basis through friends, families, friends of friends are approached with, hey, I've got this great deal. It's either a new business.
Yeah.
It's a new technology. It could be ATM machines. It could be new technology.
We know that, Bart? How do we know we hear all these things?
Because our clients come to us as their advisors,
CFO of their family wealth, right?
And we help to kind of vet these.
Right.
I mean, 99 times out of 100, they're not worthy,
or not mature enough, and they're not quite ready for investment.
Correct. And then they've got the family members that, hey, invest with me in this deal or in this house, or why don't you finance my house? So those are the kind of things, I think, when you're looking for the new deal or the next deal, as something that worth having, you know, your advisor take a look and or spend considerable amount of time doing the due diligence.
Right. Can I ask a question? Because you deal with the uber wealthy here.
Yeah.
And my, when I've brushed up against them in past lives here, like as an entertainment publicist, I found them to be very frugal as a group. Whereas most people think, you got a lot of money. Hey, come on, take a flyer with me. What do you got to lose? And they're not easy sells for these get-quick schemes. Well, like everybody somehow thinks, I'm going to approach them because I know them and they got money, and they'll take a shot. Whereas I find them to be more conservative than other people because they've already got it and they don't want to lose it.
Well, those are definitely the more informed ones.
It depends.
The ones that have better judgment, but I would not say we see that on a more regular basis.
Really? Okay.
Yeah, it really depends.
They're willing to take risks just because they think they can, or because I've done such a good job the first time around, it's going to work the second time around.
It's the casino mentality. I won the first time up. I can't lose now here.
But another takeaway from, and I agree with that, another takeaway from here is, and we've done this with a number of our clients, we find out what they're, and we've used this term before, it's called your family index, right? So Family wealth index. We go through the whole process, and at the end, and I'm going to pull a number that we've had for recent clients, 4%. 4%, Mr. and Mrs. Client, you're going to go anywhere in the world you want, live the lifestyle that you want, be able to take care of your family that you want. All you need is 4%.
And we find out what their unique number is, and what he's saying is this number represents is how much does your portfolio need to grow? It's just so you're living off of that percentage of growth, and then
it's
that way
growing.
The principal is able to continue to maintain.
And
over
that seems
time.
Achievable. Oh, geez, 4%. You're not asking for 40%. Yeah.
No, and I mean, it
everyone's
depends on
different.
Circumstances, how much money you have, what your expenses are.
How much risk you're willing to take.
And my point to that is, so let's say this same client, Mr. Client, come to me, and we know their family wealth index is 4%. And they say, Bart, Letitia, I've just been given this amazing opportunity to earn, you name it, 15% a year, 20% a year in this investment, this new technology, whatever it is. And then the answer is, well, you only need 4. Are you really willing to risk X amount of dollars to get something more than you really, really need? And so, in most cases, they don't do it. But that's, I think that all falls under that same thing about what's my next deal? I got to be in it.
Yeah, and that's why I just want to make sure that I'm clear what I'm saying is the information that we're providing here is not advice. It does not mean that you can make it on a 4% growth. Everyone has their own unique investment objective, and we come up with a unique situation for every single client based on a formula that we do. But to add to Bart's thought process is everyone is different, everyone's unique, but there is an ability for you to come up with some number or a range that you can use and then go from there.
Somebody tweeted in a question, I think it's a good one here. Do your clients as a group want to retire, or are they looking for a continual deal growth involvement? In my parents' era, it was all striving for that day when you could stop and play golf or do nothing.
I would say most of our clients, even though they're retired, they then have the flexibility to do what they want to do and redefine that next phase.
And that's why we've really redefined retirement to the term financial independence, which means maybe I am going to take a year off. Maybe I'll take a few years off. Maybe I'll travel the world and come back and do something. And maybe I'll be a golf pro, and earn X dollars instead of millions of dollars.
But they're not striving to do the World War II generation's view of get to a point and then stop.
I seen a client come in recently, and they were like, I want to be done, tap, tap, I'm done. They have a very high earning income, and that both spouses do. And at the end of the day, they were just done with the stress and the pressure of this really the day-to-day of their current job. But at the end of the day, what they were looking for is retirement. But then that followed up with, okay, well, then I can start doing consulting.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
so they wanted to retire, but then they wanted to create a job.
Because I personally don't think our generation, I think we're going to we already have redefined retirement. Yeah. I don't think it is
correct.
The notion of one day I'm working 40 hours, the next day I just stop and I do nothing but play for the rest of my life.
And then you're going to have my generation that's going to mess you guys all up. And we're yeah. like, we want flexibility of time, space, duration, and we want it all now, and then we'll keep on working.
There is one particular profession that really seems to want to retire, and it, I think it would shock maybe even you, Letitia.
Yeah.
Earlier than you would think.
Okay.
Teachers.
Doctors.
Oh.
Really?
Yeah.
They put so much, they're burned out?
I think the state of medicine today I don't want to get political, but just with the differences and
the paperwork and the difficulty.
Yeah, I hear it's taken away from the joy. So I for the same reason, I thought
we do have a lot of doctor clients. Yeah, that makes sense.
And they're the ones that want to retire.
Interesting.
The
earliest. Yeah. Okay.
Interesting observation, Bart.
Yeah.
Okay. What's our next question?
All right. This one was kind of surprising too. Now this gentleman of a client is still really developing net worth, but it's a great, great wage earner. So and he's still working years. He happens to be in his mid-50s, and his wife is significantly younger, like by about 15 years younger.
Okay.
So his first answer without hesitation was, I want to make sure my younger wife is taken care of.
Which makes sense. There's an age gap.
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, there's some obvious things, but there.
Bart, I want to ask you: was the wife, since he is a, and you don't have to share the details, but because he is a high income earner, does she or does she not work?
She does not. They have.
So she does not work. So that makes more sense that now he wants to make sure that she takes care of her because she's not working, and when she wants to maintain that lifestyle that they've created together and for a longer duration of time.
Right. Right.
Because women live longer as well.
So
I hate that.
So let me start with the obvious one, and I kind of joked with him because I said, "Well, thank you very much for that, Mr. Klein." I said, "No, the obvious solution is just hey, get some life insurance. Call me when you're ready." which was meant as kind of slapstick, but anyway, that is still a solution.
Yeah.
Another one is, and part of it you have to kind of bet on yourself and bet on your life because there are people who say, "I don't want life insurance." Great, fine. Then make sure you have enough money. And when are you going to have enough money?
Okay, so just so we're clear. So one solution would be life insurance. What else?
So have a nest egg that's going to generate an income. It's basically the golden goose, the goose that lays the golden egg. So we have to backwards schedule. Let's say someone has expenses of $50,000 a year.
Okay.
And if we go back to that family wealth index of 4 or 5%.
Correct.
And let's use 5 in this case. So $1 million in a goose, and that's going to be $50,000 a year. That's 5% times $1 million. If that's enough for your wife and family to live on, you're great. You're golden. And then it's also very linear. So if it's $500,000 a year where someone needs, and that's $10 million. So one might say, great, you know what? I don't want to buy life insurance. I'm going to save till I get that money. Great, perfect. What happens if you get hit by a truck tomorrow?
Okay, hold on a second. Paul, did you understand that? Because you're of our audience.
Yeah, not totally. Yeah.
So can you explain that maybe just a little bit?
I think what he was trying to say, let me say it and then see wherever I'm wrong here.
Thank you.
You're trying to say one way to do it other than life insurance is to set aside a certain amount of money in some investment that pays a certain percent
that you can assume some type of rate of return
where I'm trying to wrap my head around. How do you, other than a CD or something, how do you know what it's going to do over 20
30
years?
You can have a projection of a rate of return based on a portfolio that you created. That's a little bit more of like you can talk with an advisor to help you come up with that.
Right.
We're not talking about guaranteed, we're just talking about a target rate of return.
And by the way, this is I'm talking nest egg, so it could be a rental property, it could be stocks, bonds, whatever it is, but something that generates
a 5% rate of return.
And that's
a rate of return.
And Paul, that was just an assumed moderate rate of return.
I'm not trying to be the voice of doom and curse your young client's young wife here, but we all know the chances of people getting remarried are high. And I'm wondering if that suddenly changes, that he's 70 and she's 50, and suddenly he's like, oh my goodness, I'm not so concerned. She's cheating on me, or she's going to leave me, or whatever. I don't know. I hear all these kind of horrible stories.
That's a great question. So I was going to actually already add to Bart's point, because he said life insurance. But another piece to add to that is trustee services. So depending on your estate and depending on your state that you live in, every state has different rules and regulations. But you can set up a trust account, and that you can have a trustee service that helps you with distributing your assets to your estate. So that could be your wife, that could be your children, that could be whomever you wanted, that trustee is able to distribute to your family.
And there's some changeability. Maybe the divorce is a bad thing, but here's what I hear more often. My kid's on cocaine, or my kid's a screw-up,
yeah,
but I want to take care of my kid, you know, in some way, shape, or form here or something. And yet, if they're doing bad things, I don't leave money. But if they're doing good things, I want to support them.
And that's called a trust. And so if they're still alive, you can have some trust that you can still make changes to. And you can have provisions and rules and regulations. And that person who's the trustee is just the person who's in charge of the trust. And the trust itself has its own rules. And then some of them, after they've passed, then those rules are set. And they don't get to make those changes, and that's irrevocable. So there's lots of options, and we can go into trust and estate. But just to say that's a solution, that if they can, like you said, you can have some type of rate of return, you can have some type of guarantee, or you can have a trustee services that says, okay, we are able to distribute X amount of dollars per month, or whatever amount that they need, based on the same lifestyle that they've already created. So they can set that up, and it gives them a peace of mind.
And I think it's important that I clarify, just because of the business we're in, we're not promising, there's no promise of guarantee or a 5% or guarantee of 5%.
Clearly,
this was just
an example projection.
Right.
Yeah.
But it's interesting. So you've got a client, they're concerned about taking care of their...
Our compliance would be happy.
Wife and children.
Their clarification.
And I'm just saying, what if things change down the road? How flexible are some of these things here?
And it all depends. And that's why you have a team in place. So you have an attorney that drafts a trust, and you would have a trustee services that help implement it. And you have advisors like us that can help with the investments.
You did a show once before on trusts, and I wonder, is it really... that you would think everybody you know has a trust. Do they?
It really depends, and everyone has a different, unique situation.
I mean, is it
90% of our clients do, because we hound them until they get one.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. It depends.
But they don't think of it necessarily on their own. They come into it thinking, I've got plenty of years, and I'm not going to worry about it. And then you're trying to say, well, what if? Start asking the what if questions.
And that's what we try to come up with, solutions for them to their what ifs that they might not be able to think of. And that's why we're doing shows like this. What keeps you up at night, trying to help you, and just also everyone that's the audience that wants to hear, what are some real life solutions that we would have with our clients? And that's the conversation we're having now.
So I'd like to slide in one last one, so I know we have a few more minutes. Again, a very, very, very successful gentleman. And he had two. Again, these were off the top of his head. Yes. And the first one is, and although it's nothing really, really we can help him with, but I'm going to share it because he shared it with me, and it's something that I have as my issue too. Waking up in the middle of the night and then forgetting to take something from his mental to-do list.
Oh my gosh, you do that all the time.
Yeah, it keeps me up from 2 o'clock in the morning.
I will wake up at 2 a.m. and now I have a pen and paper on the side of my desk or my bed, and I actually draw, like, write things down.
Yeah.
I used to take notes on my phone, which is bad, because then all of a sudden I'm awake.
Yeah.
And then I'm looking at my email.
Yeah.
And then I'm looking at everything.
My late great father taught me very early. He said, keep a pen and paper by your bedside. Rather than dwell on it, write it down, and then it's done, and forget about it, and go to sleep.
Yeah.
I'm going to share that. Oh, he's going to be listening to this, so you know who you are.
No, how many people do that? I've suffered from that at times. One more idea.
Jerry Seinfeld did in one of his episodes. Did
he? Jokes. Yeah.
So the second thing for him, he's approaching 60, and he said, I have a real fear of death right now. Mm. He says, my dad passed away some years ago. My mom just passed away. He goes, I'm pretty much next in line. And, you know, he made a pretty interesting comment. When he was 50, he said, I'm basically halfway there. Well, halfway there on a really, really good lifespan, right? That means you're 100. And when you're 60, you know, who knows how many years. So part of that is, you know, kind of the fear of death. And then kind of a little bit consistent with the gentleman who wants to take care of his wife is, am I prepared? If something were to happen, am I fully prepared?
Yeah.
So that's another case of, you know, it does take step, it does take action, but, you know, work with your advisor.
I think you guys are doing God's work just getting him to ask and think through these things, because I fear I'm more like most baby boomers. We're the Peter Pan generation. We're never going to get old. I don't want to hear about any of this. I don't want to worry about it. I don't want to think about it. And then we put it off and put it off until it's too late.
Yeah, and I can't stress that enough, that I mean, it's funny. Bart even makes fun of me on this show. I'm like, let's talk about how to prepare for death and what your family does. And he's like, I don't want to talk about that. But at the end of the day is we do talk about that with our clients, because you just never know. And you don't want your family to be in the situation that they're not prepared. And so all you can do is, you don't know if you have tomorrow. No one really knows if we have tomorrow, what that looks like. So let's prepare today. So then tomorrow, worst case scenario, your family is taken care of.
Yeah. Yeah.
When my parents passed away and I'm an only child, I had the same overwhelming thought. Oh, my God. After I cried for them, I cried for me. I'm next.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm next. How did I get to be the old person in the room? How did I get to be the next one in line?
Yeah.
Yeah, and I think that's a scary place.
We got to take care of guys. We'll be here to take care of you guys.
Okay, I hope so, because you live longer.
All right, Letitia, we're near the end, so I know this is your favorite part. Tell everybody how to see us, watch us, hear us.
Yeah, so
contact us.
We have a ton of places you can find us, but if you're listening to our podcast from our email, it's actually on our email in the bottom of the email. You can just click the button, super easy. On all of our social media, you have a URL, and they're all there as well. You can click the link, and it has the most recent show, so you can download it there. It'll take you to Podbeam, and there is where you can listen to us live. We're also on iHeartRadio. We're on iTunes, but it's Zan Bergen Report, Wealth Strategies and Investment Wisdom. So here's my question for you. If you like our show, please make a comment that's positive. And I know they're laughing. And please share it with one of your friends, because our message isn't any good unless we're actually out there and people hear from us. So love to hear from you, what you want to hear. Even if you like it, just put a smiley face or some type of comment or share it with your friend. That's awesome. And it helps us know that you guys are liking what we're sharing with
and
you.
And I can't stress enough how much Apple and others, when they're deciding what to suggest to someone, they look at that and say, how many likes has somebody gotten? So if you think this is good stuff and you hope others will find it, that's how they do.
And also share with us what keeps you up at night. This is going to be a theme that we're going to continue with. So
I think it could be a book or something.
It could be one of our mailbags. All right, everyone, thanks so much for tuning in. We look forward to being in studio again next week. Thank you. Cheers.
Tune in next week for the latest edition of the Zan Bergen Report, Tuesdays at 2 p.m. Catch up on our recent shows by visiting bartzanbergen.podbean.com. The Zan Bergen Report is also available on iTunes, iHeartRadio, and Spotify. Interested in being a featured guest on our show, or have a question you'd like to hear us answer? Email podcast@bartzanbergen.com. Bart A. Zanbergen, CFP, and Letitia Burbaum, AIF, are registered investment advisors with Optivest, Inc., and registered representatives with Gramercy Securities, Inc., member FINRA and SIPC. Investment advisory services are offered by Optivest, Inc. under SEC registration.